Coming up on this episode of DL Weekly, the early bird gets the touch of Disney worm, tips for making Touch of Disney a better experience, Avengers campus updates,
some fun surprises for guests and legacy pass holders. We talk about our planning for our visit to Touch of Disney and more. DL Weekly starts now.
Welcome to DL Weekly, a podcast about Walt's original Magic Kingdom, Disneyland. We cover the latest news and information from the resort, test our skills at trivia, and have a discussion about the parks every week. We invite you to send in your feedback and stories. Our contact information can be found at dlweekly.net. Now sit back, keep your hands and arms inside the podcast, and enjoy this week's show.
And welcome to this episode of DL Weekly for the week of March 24th, 2021. I'm Teg Bushman.
And I'm Teresa Urban. We would like to send a shout out and a big thank you to all of our current weekly tiers for supporting the show. Without your support, DL Weekly would not be possible. Side note, that's we're talking about our next trip in the discussion topic. We are so excited.
Yes.
But if you would like to become an official weekly tier, head on over to dlweekly.net/support to sign up.
All right. So we have another D180 from our friends over at Concierge.
Hello, everyone. This is Eric Johnson with Concierge, and welcome to the D180. While Teg and Teresa cover all things Disneyland, in the D180, we take a spin around the rest of the Disney universe, and we do it in 180 seconds. Let's jump right in. We begin our tour in Walt Disney World, where preparations for the 50th anniversary continue. Work continues on the Tron coaster in the Magic Kingdom, but the biggest changes are happening at Epcot. Remy's Ratatouille Adventure is set to open the same day as the 50th celebration begins on October 1st. This trackless ride from Disneyland Paris is sure to please families in Epcot's expanded France Pavilion. Construction walls pop up and move around Epcot with great frequency. The brunt of changes will not be finished by the anniversary, but I'll bet there'll be plenty to see by October. Disney Imagineers released some pictures this week showing off the lights that will be part of the sparkling effect on Spaceship Earth later this autumn. The biggest news in Epcot always seems to center around World Showcase Lagoon. Disney keeps installing new barges for the nighttime spectacular Harmonious around the waterway. They run calibration tests day and night, but we still don't know much about how this new show will compare to the concept art released so long ago. Here's hoping Harmonious is just amazing as it promises. Let's head further east, across the Atlantic to Disneyland Paris. Okay, I get it. It's closed. Again. After months of the park opening and closing based on infection rates in Europe, it's safe to say their gates will not be open for a bit. Disney confirmed this week that they will defer the April 2nd opening date indefinitely. Even though the park is not open right now, Imagineers, specifically named the Magic Keepers, are hard at work on the two French parks. Their efforts to modernize rides, repair facades, refurbish fountains, and improve on all those Disney details around the resort are hard to see, for us, but much appreciated. When Disneyland Paris reopens for good, guests will experience a good-as-new park ready to welcome new friends and old. If we keep moving eastward, we soon find ourselves in Shanghai Disneyland. This park will celebrate its 5th anniversary this year, and it's pulling out all the stops. Those of you who remember the celebrations at American parks in the 5s and 10s will see some similar festivities made modern. Instead of a big prize wheel to spin, ask your Disney nerd friends if you missed that one, guests in the park can use their Shanghai Disney app to access prizes once they enter the Chinese park's gates. Lucky guests might encounter the Surprise Squad, a group of cast members ready to pump up the celebratory spirit. These entertainers will put on a brief show and invite guests around them to the Disney Surprise Show in Tomorrowland. Once there, guests can see a quick stage show and get a chance to win even more prizes. Dining experiences, hotel stays, park tickets, annual passports, too soon Disneylanders, even visits to the park's version of Club 33, everything is on the table with this prize patrol. They're no Chevy Cavalier, but the prizes seem pretty cool to me. Well, that's 180 seconds. I hope you enjoyed our quick spin around the Disney universe. If you would like to learn more about these Disney adventures or just have a few questions, please come on over and visit our pages and websites of both DL Weekly and us, their official travel planners, Concierge. We look forward to planning something special for you and your family. I'm Eric Johnson, and this has been your D180.
So we have some other exciting news. We've talked about this on the last couple episodes, but we actually have some details this time. So we are going to be at Touch of Disney, as we have said, and we will say for our planning a little bit later. But we are going to have a meetup with fellow Weekly Tiers. So if you guys are in the area and want to come say hi and socially distanced wave at each other and have some conversation and just share our love for Disney, we will be at the AMC seating area. So in the front where the AMC theaters are, there's like an area with a bunch of tables and chairs. And we will be meeting people there at 9 a.m. or around 9 a.m. that Sunday, the 28th.
Yes. So the AMC theater seating is also very close to the new Raya mural. I'm really excited about being able to see that too. So Downtown Disney does open at 9. So I'm not sure if we'll be on time or we might be late to our own party. I apologize, but we will be getting over there as quickly as we can.
And how long are we thinking we might stay? So if people should head out or not?
So since we do have Touch of Disney tickets, we will probably be wrapping up the meetup, I'd say around like 10:30, 10:45.
That sounds good.
So then we can make our way down to the Touch of Disney event, because I do know that there are other Weekly Tiers that also have their tickets for the event as well. So excited. So excited. Luna's excited too.
Yep. I'm very excited to be there, because to be back in a park again, and after, you know, this year of everything going on, and it'll just be nice to be there. I'm just afraid that I'm not going to have enough stomach.
So it's a good thing we have multiple days there.
I thought you were going to say it's a good thing we have multiple stomachs. I'm like,
we're bringing our spare stomachs just in case.
Like a cow. Doesn't a cow have like four stomachs or something?
There you go. Now let's get to the news. Arriving early seems to be best when it comes to Touch of Disney. For those folks staying at a hotel on Harbor, the access is easier and you can arrive to Downtown Disney earlier than the 11:30 a.m. Mickey and Friends crowds. For locals, there is also the option to park at the Anaheim Hotel for $10 and walk over. Another option, too, that I saw were people were parking at the Simba lot.
Oh.
And going into Downtown Disney that way. The crowds do pick up in the afternoon and early evening, so getting in and ordering some food right away is a good idea. Avoiding food and checking out the characters and photo ops in the afternoon when it is busiest is probably a great idea. Another thing you could do too in those busy afternoons, dining reservations at either Lamplight or Carthay.
You're only saying that because
we just scored some dining reservations, so that was crazy, unexpected surprise that they just happened to release more dining reservations this afternoon. And
I did read online that day of, they keep about a third of capacity for day of. Mm-hmm. So your first thing should be go to one of these locations and see if you can get on the wait list if you're arriving right around the start of the event. So I'm glad that people, when it comes to arriving, I'm glad that we've learned these things, because we were unsure last week about being able to arrive from Harbor, because it seemed like everybody was going to be funneled over to the Mickey and Friends structure and have to go that way. So it is good. One of the with the link in the show notes from the Disney Food Blog, they said that it had taken them 80 minutes from parking in Mickey and Friends to getting in on Buena Vista Street. So that's quite a while.
Yeah. Another thing, too, that we've now learned that I'm really excited about is that you can enter, of course, from Mickey and Friends walking down the tram route. You can enter from, like Tag just mentioned, Harbor, but you also can walk through Downtown Disney. So if you do want to go super early and do breakfast, or maybe come to a DL Weekly Tier meetup in the morning, hint, hint, you can also enter the queuing area for Touch of Disney from Downtown Disney.
Touch of Disney hasn't been all sunshine and churros. Guests online and even in our community reported some hiccups with the opening weekend of the event. Guests arriving to Mickey and Friends at 11:30 when the garage opened had to walk the tram route, which resulted getting to the gates after the noon start time. Entrance was slowed down due to having to scan the ticket, take guests' photos, then scan the $25 food gift card to enter. Mobile ordering is highly encouraged, like we said before, but also had long waits for food once ordered that in some cases was faster just to stand in the line and order at the booth instead.
It's, you know, unfortunately, there's always going to be hiccups. with opening day things. And, you know, kind of keep in mind, this is the first big event that Disneyland has put on. Yes, of course, they've been doing very well at Walt Disney World. But, you know, some kinks. We have heard reports from Weekly Tears and other sources that there did seem to be a lot of people in suits walking around this weekend, walking around opening day. So hopefully they were taking notes and getting things straightened out, and things will be running smoother when it starts back up this week.
Yeah, I hope so.
The other thing that this has me, this will be, we'll talk about this later in our discussion topic too, but this has got me a little confused because I've heard different thought processes on how to, what the most efficient way to order and get your food is. And so I'm a little confused by the whole thing.
I heard that there's like one booth you can go to and you can order for everywhere, and you keep your receipt and you just walk up. So I don't know if that's better. Especially if you have a list, because I know we're going to talk about that later. Some people, Liberty, one of our community managers, she's got a whole list.
She's got a Google, a Google spreadsheet.
Yeah. Awesome. So is it going to be better to just go to that booth and order your top things?
See, this is my worry with that. I would be like, ooh, can I get this, this, this? Ooh, maybe that too. And oh, yes, that, and that. And then all of a sudden, I have like 10 items, and I'm after item three, I'm like, I can't possibly eat anymore. Well, then what do you do? You know? You've already paid for all this stuff. I don't think you can then go say, just kidding, can I have a refund?
Well, yeah, because there's no way for them to know if you went and picked it up or not.
And especially having to order all the food right at the beginning, I'd be way too excited and for sure over-order.
That's why, in opposition to what everybody else seems to be doing, which is highly planning, especially with talking to people in our chat, I am just going to let the Disney food winds take me wherever.
The smells.
Well, James, I was asking James the other day, I said, what do you think I should do? You think I should go through a list and figure out what I want? And he said, I think that you should know the stuff that you really want to try and you don't want to miss, which I think I already have chosen in my head. And then everything else, you should just see if you feel like it at the time.
Yeah. Well, the other nice thing, too, is since we're going together, we can do some like order thing, cut it in half, and both share a thing so we can try
more stuff
without having to like commit to the full portion.
I'm just concerned because I know how I am, because we did this at Epcot and we did this when we were at Disneyland last time, is I'll find something that was really good and my brain will just be like, I want to kind of go back and have that again, but I have to like turn myself away from that this time.
Well, I think the lines will be turning you away from doing that this time around, because if you have to wait another hour to get that same taco, you'd probably be like, so it wasn't that good.
Right.
The one thing I'm worried about, we need to stop talking about this. I'm worried about only wanting the skewers and like not getting away from the skewers. I'm so excited for the skewers and the Dole Whip. Well, something interesting popped up online this week with guests being able to see different angles into Avengers Campus with Touch of Disney going on. It appears that the Web Slingers attraction has part of the track outside on the roof. We looked at some aerial photos to see if we could 100% confirm this, but there wasn't a good angle to do so. There is a piece of concept art that has Mission Breakout in the background, so could this show proof of this? We were under the impression that the stunt show would be in this area as well, so we will see when the land is open and this attraction is also open to the public what this actually looks like.
So I was telling Teresa before we started recording today that this was the very first story that she had pasted in our rundown for me to like write, and I spent about an hour trying to find the Mice Chat aerial photos to see if there was a track. I was looking at different sides of the building to see, does it even make sense physically for these vehicles to be able to get up there? I don't know.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying that there is or isn't an outdoor portion. In one of the concept art pictures,
which the interesting thing to me is, never did I realize the concept art had a blue sky with clouds.
Yeah. So in this picture, there's a blue sky with clouds. Okay. Same concept art, but a different version. There is Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout in the background. So I don't know if this is part of the attraction, like if this is going to be like legitimately the outside, or is this going to be like something projected on the inside or what? There's so many questions that I didn't even know I had.
The other thing, too, is look at the back of this photo in this concept art. This looks like there's like a ship parked behind them, too, doesn't it?
It does kind of look like that. Yeah, it's so I don't know. We've never heard anything about there being an outdoor portion. So I was kind of caught off guard with this. So I didn't want to have this us report on this and being there's an outdoor portion and then we're wrong. But I also didn't want to not say anything and then there was. So we'll see. The other thing I thought of, and I told Teresa, and I think she was like, oh, that'd be cool, is maybe the Stuntronic isn't for the show. Maybe the Stuntronic is for that scene of the attraction. That would be super
cool. That would be amazing.
But I guarantee you that'll be like the first thing that breaks down.
Yeah,
it just seems like one of those things. Attendees of the Touch of Disney event are able to look into Avengers Campus, like we said, and see one of the decorative highlights of the new area, the Quinjet. It is parked on top of the location of the possible future location of the Phase 2 big Avengers E-ticket attraction.
Avengers, Marvel, not like my thing. I'm really excited about like the animated side of Disney is like my jam. So I wasn't as excited. Like, I thought it was cool that we were going to get like a Marvel themed area. I appreciated that. However, the more that we're kind of like the more sneak peeks and the more things that we're seeing, the more excited I'm getting about this land. So one of the weird things that I'm now did not think I would be, but I'm very excited about for going to Touch of Disney is like
seeing this,
peeking into this land that is not open to the public yet.
But that's not necessarily because it's Avengers. That's just because it's like a new place.
I suppose.
If people could have peeked into Galaxy's Edge, people would have been doing that stuff too.
That's true. Very true. Well, guests were greeted with some unexpected refurbishments going on within California Adventure at the start of the Touch of Disney event. The rotunda for Ariel's Undersea Adventure is behind scaffolding and being painted, as well as quite a bit of work around Pacific Wharf, specifically the Cocina Cucamonga, which is open, by the way, and is also where you get those wonderful skewers.
Oh, the Bengal barbecue skewers.
That's where you get the Bengal barbecue skewers.
Oh, I'm so excited for this. The other thing that's interesting going on with some of these food locations that I've seen reported is a lot of the outdoor ordering stations where a cast member would be to take your order here and the Paradise Gardens have been removed.
Yes.
There's only like one station at each of these places. So they are really heavily going to mobile ordering.
Yeah. The other thing I was thinking about too is there's a lot of speculation and a little bit of fear that people are saying like, oh no, are these going to be permanently removed? And are they just going to always be mobile? You know, are they going to force us into always doing mobile ordering and we won't have the cashiers? I don't believe that. I think it makes sense because one of the articles in the photographs actually points out that there is a social distancing line marker in the spot of where one of those cashier wraps
were.
So I think they just needed the space
maybe
right now, so they were able to distance the lines better.
I mean,
so
they can always put it back.
Exactly.
I don't know. In our experience so far with mobile ordering, I think it's good. Again, one of the unexpected things to come out of the pandemic era is people more being open to doing things like mobile ordering. So I think going forward, there's a lot of these things that have cropped up during this time that will stick around. Reservations is another one. Mm-hmm. So I'm kind of excited because I would much rather order my food on the way to the place and then just be able to walk up and pick up my food. Obviously, with like the Touch of Disney event, they're like the only attraction at this event other than a couple little character things is food. But I think in normal times for the park, once the parks do reopen, that mobile ordering will be a lot better for a lot of things.
Yeah.
And you won't have to wait as long. There won't be as many bugs.
Yeah. So the thing that I like about walking up to a restaurant is looking at the menu and standing there looking at the menu. So I was just imagining Touch of Disney, if I didn't pre-plan kind of how I wanted to attack the park food-wise, it would be a little over. Like, I feel like I'd have to keep, like, stopping to just stare at my phone. And that's the last thing I want to do when I'm in a Disney park. I don't want to stare at my phone.
Sure.
However, once the attractions are open and you're standing in queues, it wouldn't be as, like, obnoxious for me to, like, check out menus on my phone while we're standing.
Especially if you're stuck in one spot of the queue.
You're standing in a queue. So I would be more okay with that. But thinking about it for Touch of Disney and just having to keep pulling out the phone and looking at the phone, I don't. It's very weird. I kind of forget I have a phone until, like, later I'm like, oh, why have I not taken any pictures?
So here's a question for you. So I don't remember, and maybe somebody in our live stream chat could tell, too, if you don't know. Can you set it for a pickup time, like, later?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You can choose a pickup window, yeah. And then when you get there, you say,
I'm here
now.
Okay, because the reason I ask is, I'm not going to get into it for the podcast, but my mom's been in the hospital. And one of the things that's been nice for her is when we show up around lunchtime, we order her lunch through the television. Mm-hmm. And then she's like, let's just order dinner now, too. Order dinner. So I'm wondering, for people who are planners, if you already know where you want to eat later, maybe you have it all scheduled out. And maybe when you first get in the park in the morning, one of the things you do is you mobile order. And then you're like, okay, at 4 o'clock, we should be here and pick up our order. And then you don't really have to think about food the rest of the day. That's already had everything already ordered. So that could be kind of a neat idea. I'm very temperamental and situational when it comes to food. So it's like, today I might feel like that, but tomorrow maybe I won't. Yeah. Or even earlier in the day, maybe like something sounds good, but then later it doesn't. Mm-hmm. So for me, I don't think that would necessarily work unless it's something I know I love. Sushi is one of those things. I will always eat sushi.
Or Bengal barbecue.
Bengal barbecue is another one. Exactly. So one amazing thing that has returned to the Touch of Disney event are the PhotoPass photographers. There are a number of locations that have been set up to take advantage of their return. There are also some locations that are set up without PhotoPass photographers that are just plain fun. There is a Mickey mural on the side of the D-Lish booth, a D23 Mickey Hands mural near Ghirardelli, Butterfly Wings by Paradise Garden, and more. For a complete list, check out the link in our show notes.
So I'm pretty excited about that because one of the highlights and one of the huge values of a Disney park, especially if you have an annual pass and it's included, is that they have professional photographers right there willing to take your photos in super iconic, awesome places. And the fact that you don't have to always just purchase their photos, they're also willing to use your cameras and your phones to take the pictures for you. I am really hoping there is a PhotoPass photographer that I kept not running into, but she kept bumping into my family and took photos of my family twice when we were there in September of 2019 for the Oogie Boogie Bash. One of the mornings, they had an extra magic hour. I had an annual pass. So I said, don't wait for me. Go ahead. Go in the park. Enjoy your extra magic hour. I'll come in later. No problem. And so they were wearing a DL Weekly button. And their photographer, Yannette, was like, oh, where'd you get that button? So anyways, they struck up a conversation. They got to know each other. Well, then the day that I left, they were in Cars Land. And Yannette just happened to be the photo pass photographer in Cars Land. So they chatted again, and
let's hope she came back from furlough. Didn't have to go get a job elsewhere or something.
Well, during the Touch of Disney event, the Games of Pixar Pier are open for guests to enjoy. I'm stupidly excited about this. Dividers have been installed, and the seats and cast members are cleaning and sanitizing between each game. The games were free to play during the event, but it's unclear if they're going to remain that way.
During Touch of Disney.
Yes, during the Touch of Disney.
They definitely are probably going to be a fee when the park reopens, for sure.
Yes, this is like a hidden gem that nobody knew about.
We just played it a little bit when we were there for D23, and that's the only time I've ever played these. But they were fun.
And from what I've seen of people that were there and reports, Pixar Pier was very quiet. And so not a lot of people were back there and noticed that this was a extra little perk. So I'm excited to go play some of the Pixar Pier games.
Yeah.
They're if you've never done them, they're carnival style games. So there's one where you have racing horses. Of course, they're themed to Bullseye.
Yeah.
There's one that's themed to La Luna.
My question is this.
Wally, that was the other
one. One of the reasons you pay is because you get a prize. So are they not giving out prizes
at
this time?
I've heard that they are, and I've heard that they are not. So I don't know if they maybe
they'd be
just
giving away free stuff.
Yeah,
then.
So I don't know if maybe it was just on opening day they were awarding prizes, and then after opening day they were just letting you play for free. I don't know. Some people said yes they were, and other people said that it was just play for free. So I don't know.
Legacy Passholders have a few places to pick up some nice swag at Touch of Disney. Over in Paradise Gardens, there is a AP corner with a photo op for the 20th anniversary of Disney California Adventure, along with a Legacy Passholder magnet and button. The 65th anniversary of Disneyland AP magnet is also still available at most merchandise locations. Just be sure to ask. We actually had one of our weekly tiers in our chat get four of them that they were giving away.
I'm surprised that they still have the 65th anniversary of magnets. I was really, really surprised by that. One thing also, Legacy Pass holders to note, is that the Legacy Pass holder corner is only open until 6 o'clock, even though the Touch of Disney event does go until 8 p.m. So make sure, if you want to go get your magnet and your button, that you get over there before 6 o'clock.
You don't leave it for the last thing you do at the end of the night.
I'll just grab it on my way out because we're just going to do one big circle
a couple times because I want the magnet and the button.
You get both. More details have been trickling out about the new storyline and theming for the world-famous Jungle Cruise this past week. The new story will center around Alberta Falls, the granddaughter of famed explorer Albert Falls. Now where have we heard his name before? And this is she's now the proprietor of the Jungle Navigation Company who operates the Jungle Cruise. For full details, visit the links that we have in the show notes.
Which I have to pop in here. So, Vern.
Youth.
Did Teresa tell you about the fact that they are retheming the Jungle Cruise?
I heard about it on this podcast that I listen to sometimes.
Oh!
There was a mention of it.
What do you think?
I think that some change is good, and keeping things up to date and the occasional retheming is a very necessary and good thing. And sometimes you got to do stuff. So I'm generally slow to adapt to change. But I recognize that change needs to happen, and the particular changes that will be happening are good changes that I approve of, and way to go change.
Well, I was just curious because I know that some of the parts of the attraction are not going to be like they were before. Mm-hmm. Some of the things, like the rhino scene, is just going to be slightly rethemed. It's like the same thing.
Right.
But all of the tribes people and the headhunters, everything, that's all going to be gone.
Yeah, you're going to have a crash jungle. I'm curious to see like how they're going to do the like crashed jungle cruise boat or the abandoned jungle cruise boat. If it's going to be like an actual ride vehicle, or is it going to be a set piece that they build? I don't know.
It might be an old ride vehicle. Because that's what they did with the Mike Fink keel boats, is they just docked one off to the side. So
that's true.
Well, I'm glad that you're okay with it, Vern, because I know that like the Jungle Cruise is very close to your heart.
Well, and also this just means more opportunity for new jokes.
Exactly. I was going to say the Jungle Cruise is near and dear to Vern's heart, mainly for the jokes.
Entirely for the jokes. Don't say mainly. Entirely.
So
an opportunity for new jokes. I mean, I only make it out there once every other year or so, and when I can already be able to talk along with almost every single joke, it's time for get some new stuff. So.
It'll be like experiencing the attraction for the first time again.
There you go.
Yes.
The other thing that I was like nerding out excited about is that this is going to like somehow link in with the Society of Explorers and Adventurers, the Sea Club, if you will, which I wish I would have been able to go to their clubhouse that used to be at Walt Disney World in their downtown Disney area, which was at that point called Pleasure Island. But it's so cool. There's this society that is like in all of the parks. I think it is so neat that like there's like hints of this
everywhere.
Everywhere. Yeah. And it's like you kind of have to know to like see it. So I'm so excited that this is another layer to that story.
They're just doing so much with this. So first of all, they're getting rid of the headhunter thing, which, mm-hmm. You're getting a female who's running it, which is great. You're getting someone who is non-white basically running it. So I think it's great. And it matches with the story really well, actually. Mm-hmm. So I'm very excited for this because it's such a beloved attraction anyway. And the fact that it seems like this is just going to make it better. And this attraction, this isn't the first time that it's changed. Originally, it was True Life, and then they switched it to similar to what we know, and then they rethemed it again when Indiana Jones came around because they changed time frames. Yep. So this is going
to
be great.
It is so crazy to me to like think back and remember that the Jungle Cruise was serious at one point. Wouldn't that be such an awkward ride?
I think it would be because we knew it and
That's true. That's very true. But I can't imagine it being a serious ride. I just can't.
The Disneyland Hotel turned 65 back in October, and there is finally some merchandise to celebrate. There are tees, a sweater, and more available at the Wonderground Gallery in downtown Disney.
I think these are cute. I do like the style. They look very similar to what we had style-wise for the 65th anniversary for Disneyland. So I did like that these tied in with that nicely. Look at Mickey with his cute little hat.
Oh, I kind of like this one with Minnie because it looks like
her bow is shiny and so 65th. Oh, I like the bow on the back. Anyways, I feel like that's something you need.
It's nice.
It's a like quarter zip sweater that has the Disneyland Hotel marquee embroidered on it. It's very sharp.
For $55, so that's not happening. So you want to hear
We get a discount. We get the extra discount.
Do you know what I have to do I have been sent with a mission by James. Oh, he has given me money even to do this. He wants a Disneyland hoodie.
He does.
But he has not specified any parameters.
Oh, but it has to have a hood?
He wants a hoodie.
That just took that one out of the room.
Well, I don't want to get him that one, but I've already loaded money on my Disney points card or whatever, so I've got that to spend too, so I think we're doing good.
There you go. Well, Salt and Straw has done it again with another interesting take on ice cream. This time, some of your favorite cereals are now an option. Some options recreate Lucky Charms, Cocoa Crisps, Peanut Butter Captain Crunch, Rice Krispies, and Corn Flakes. Did any of these sound interesting to you?
Sort of. I'm weird. I really love, although I heard, or they did at one time do this, but I loved the like fake marshmallows that they put in cereals.
Oh, yes.
And they actually made a cereal. They might even still make it.
Cereal.
That is just those.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like, you know how sometimes, so they have different, like they'll have Oreos that are like double stuffed and quadruple stuffed and like max stuffed. There is an amount that puts it over the,
sure,
okay.
Yeah.
In fact, I was telling Kate this week in our community manager chat. So Kate, was it Kate that sent us the first? Who sent us the first batch of churro toffee?
Originally was Kate.
So
Kate was the first person to introduce us to churro
recently,
toffee. And then recently I bought some that the All Enchanting Ears crew,
that's right,
shipped over to us.
So they sent it over and there was two pieces because one for Producer James, one for me. Producer James didn't want it. So I ate his and I was addicted. So then Kate was going and I had Kate buy me four pieces and mail it to me. I got down to, I'm down to the last piece, and I think I've hit my limit.
So five pieces of churro toffee is your limit? Can't do six.
Yes. Well, within like a 2 month period, yes.
Yeah. That's a lot of churro toffee.
So I think with any of these things, there's too much, mm-hmm. but Lucky Charms is the closest because they do have those marshmallow, yes, things. What about you?
I think I was interested in the Lucky Charms one as well, and also the Cocoa Crisps one.
So, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if it's anything that I will necessarily feel like I have to get when we're there.
What was the other thing we had to try it? We talked about it like a week or two ago. What did they come out with that sounded really good?
They come up with so many.
I know. I feel like they're constantly coming out with new stuff.
They are. I don't remember what it was. We'll have to, when we're there, we'll have to go check it out.
I don't know how we're going to have room. I honestly don't.
We have Wednesday.
Tortilla Joe's will have an Easter brunch menu on Sunday, April 4th, 2021. To make reservations for this unique opportunity, call 714-535-5000. The number will be in the show notes. Some of the items include breakfast burritos and enchiladas, huevos rancheros, bottomless mimosas, and more. If you like breakfast stuff from like Hispanic culture, like, this is going to be great.
And this is even great for people like myself that aren't the biggest like breakfast specific fans, because, sure, you know, these are kind of like, they're like breakfast adjacent items, sure, like a breakfast burrito. Sure, it has eggs in it, but it's still a burrito.
Yeah.
So it's kind of one of those, it's like a perfect brunch item because you have done it. You have mushed a breakfast food with, sure, a lunch food and poof.
I will say when producer Vern got the breakfast chimichanga at Disneyland, that was pretty decent. So, yeah,
that's
but
true.
Vern is kind of a chimichanga connoisseur. So,
well, Bob Chapek was interviewed by Bloomberg this week and spoke of the guest satisfaction ratings at the Disney parks since their return. And what might be a surprise to some, the satisfaction ratings are above where they were before the pandemic. This could be caused by the lower attendance levels, which makes for a more pleasant experience, the precautions Disney has taken to keep everyone safe, or just that people are happy to be out of their houses doing anything. He also stated that the parks will continue to be more magical when more guests return.
Yeah, so basically, it sounds to me like because there are less people in the parks, people are happier, obviously.
Yes.
Because, again, I think part of it, too, is because of the fact that people are just happy to be out of their house. And so even a potentially poor experience, they're just happy to be out doing, yes, anything.
And people are excited to be back in the parks.
That's true.
We had to go for so long without being in the parks, and especially with Disneyland still closed, it's just good to be in the magic again.
I just hope that they I'm sure they won't do this, but I really hope that they don't look at this and go, well, people are really happy and we don't have fireworks, we don't have parades, we don't have all this stuff, and people are happier now than they were before, so we don't have to do as much of that stuff. But I think that that's what made Disney Disney. People, they're not going to get rid of it. I'm just saying, I hope that they don't look at that and like cut down those things when they come back. That's all.
The one thing I do predict will happen, though, is I don't think we will ever see Disneyland, especially, and probably Walt Disney World. I don't think the capacities are going to be the same. I think we're going to not allow as many people in, which will probably result in higher ticket prices. But I don't think we're going to have the same crowds that we did before, because the maximum capacity just is not going to be where it was pre-pandemic.
I think reservations are going to continue to be a thing.
I think reservations will be a thing too, which I'm not mad at either of those options, because I do think both of those things overall make for a better park experience. That was one of the things that we really enjoyed in Walt Disney World, was the fact that there were times when you were in corners of the park and you felt like you had the place to yourself, because there was nobody else or very few people in that area with you. And just the fact of not having to wait 3 hours for an attraction, you know, to ride on an attraction that was only 10 minutes long or something like that, that made for a much more enjoyable experience. So I do think we'll probably see that.
So anytime they talk about crowds, every blog that posts about crowds or the news sites, they always pick like the holiday Main Street picture where it's like everybody is like shoulder to shoulder. And I look at these pictures and I go, my brain is not ready to see that again, because we're so used to, anytime I see crowds now, in fact, again, I was at the hospital today and the hospital was fairly busy and I was like, there's just so many people around me, and it wasn't even that bad, but our brains have been conditioned now throughout this year that you shouldn't be close to people. Yeah. And so it's very weird. So even like our meetup we're going to have, it's going to be interesting. Just being at Disneyland again and waiting in lines to get in the park and stuff, it's going to feel so weird.
It is. And I think that's probably another reason that we're not going to see the capacities whoosh right back up to where they were before, because we have different comfort levels now with things. So it's just interesting. It's very interesting.
I'm curious to see, as with everything, and I've said this for quite a while now, in general, in life, I'm interested to see 1 year from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, what stays and what doesn't stay, and like what's been modified. Like, who would have thought a couple years ago that like mobile ordering and reservations for park things, and who would have thought Disneyland for over a year closed?
Yeah. Well, the crazy thing on mobile ordering is mobile ordering was just like just beginning.
Yeah.
So the fact now that they had that in place, and now, you know, we're seeing events that are heavily relying on something that was just, hey, we have this, it's fun, it's convenient, check it out, you know, it's another option. It's crazy.
It's good that they had that started. Oh, can you imagine if they had to like figure all this out in the last minute?
That's true. Very true.
Well, speaking of CEOs being interviewed, the former CEO, Bob Iger, was interviewed for the SiriusXM business show Leadership Matters. He talks about leaving Disney, what he hopes to do as he transitions out of the company, and more. The interview airs on SiriusXM on April 6th.
Yes, and we will also have a link in our show notes to the nice write-up that Laughing Place did on this. And there's also, I believe there's also a link that you can listen to part of it without having the XM radio subscription.
Yeah, that'll be really nice. Side note on this. I saw a news story that was on CBS Sunday Morning about MasterClass. Have you heard of MasterClass? Oh. Mm-hmm. So it's a bunch of famous people like Serena Williams, Helen Mirren, Bob Iger, that basically they come up with these classes and they teach stuff. Well, I downloaded the Bob Iger one. And it was interesting because he talks about like business and like how he, so it's kind of a complimentary thing to his book that we've talked about, that talks about his experiences. It's all him talking about how they bought Marvel and Pixar and how they brought all that stuff in. I did watch a few little bits of the Helen Mirren one too, because she talks about acting and how hard it is to act, and she demonstrated some stuff. This is way off topic, but it's so cool to me, because she talks about how when you're on set, if you are not in the shot with the person who's in that scene with you, they're like behind the camera. So she said you're acting to like this little orange X on the side of the of the thing, and the person's like behind it. So she said it's so weird to her when people say, "What's it like working with whoever. Yeah. And she's like, well, unless we're like in a two-shot together, we're not really together, and it's not really working with them because they're like behind the camera. So it's very interesting. Anyway.
That's crazy.
Masterclass. People were talking about how expensive it is. It's like $160 for a year, and you get access to all of these things. You could get through all the ones you want. There's also one that I was looking at that was Penn and Teller teaching magic, which I thought was cool. I learned a whole thing of how to do sleight of hand. It was neat.
You'll have to show it off at the meetup.
Something. I'll have to make sure I have it available.
You need to practice. Now it's time to take a trip to Trivia Land, where producer Vern will try and stump us with some Disney trivia. He's going to ask us 4 questions, maybe even a bonus. We will attempt to answer them, and we'll get the correct answers after our discussion topic. So what do you have for us this week, Vern?
Well, welcome back to Trivia Land. We are taking another dive into those wonderful listener-submitted questions. Producer James and I are always very grateful to all of the wonderful questions that are submitted by our wonderful listeners, so please keep them coming. We do appreciate them very much. They make our jobs very much easier. So tonight we are going to start off with question number 1 from listener Melissa S. In California Adventure, the store Elias & Company has a unique replica suit in the store. Whose suit is it, and where was it worn?
Ooh.
I want to say it's like Walt's suit, but I feel like that's too easy.
I'm going to say...
Maybe it's his dad's suit.
Because it's Elias and Company. I was going to say Walt's suit that he wore to the premiere of Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. A replica of the suit that Walt wore.
I'm going to go different. I'm going to say it was a Roy suit.
Oh.
Because... Walt seems like it's too easy.
So where do you think he wore it? Because, right? That was the other part of the question?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Whose suit is it and where was it worn?
Roy's suit, and it was worn to the opening of Disney World, we'll say.
Oh.
Question number 2, submitted by listener Donna S. Who christened the Mark Twain at Disneyland?
Oh.
And what was used to do the christening?
I'm pretty sure it was Lily, Walt's wife Lily in Disney.
I think that's true.
And what was used?
It was a bottle of something.
Was it a bottle of waters around, like,
no,
from
that
the rivers?
Was, they pour, well, yes, I'm going to go with
okay,
that.
Okay, yeah, so what I was meaning when I said waters from the rivers is... So, right, the rivers of America
are supposed to be like the Mississippi and the whatever else. Yeah.
Yep. So I think it was water from different rivers in America that they christened
that are represented on the rivers.
Yep. That Lily and Disney christened the boat with.
There you go. I'm with Teresa on this one.
That was a mouthful.
So you're saying it was Lily with a bottle that had waters from all the rivers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that are represented on the rivers.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Lillian.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yep. All right. Question number 3 from listener Todd B. In the Haunted Mansion, in Madame Leota's spellbook, the incantation of Cree, Kra, Virgo, Gaba, Kalto, Cree is listed. Which Disney movie is this incantation featured in?
I think that this has got to be your little movie that you like with Madame Mim. It sounds like something she would say.
Well, can you say what the incantation was again?
Cree, Kra, Virgo, Gaba, Kalto, Cree.
No.
No, it's not Madame Mim.
I'm going to say it was Bedknobs and Broomsticks. What's her name? Angela Lansbury.
Yeah, I was going to say Angela Lansbury, but I don't remember.
I don't remember what her name is in that.
Jakaram. I'm thinking of all of her like spells that
she has
says.
A bunch of weird things. I mean, but
that's so, a good. I think you're. I'm going to go with you on that. Bedknobs and Broomsticks, because that's a very long incantation. I can't, and like Maleficent was like words.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah, because I feel like Bedknobs and Broomsticks is one of the only ones that has like gibberish.
Like the incantations.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Madame Mim just like transformed.
Sure.
She didn't have like spells.
Okay. I don't remember what her name is, but that's what it's from.
Yeah.
That's what you're going
with?
I like
how we know it's Angela Lansbury, but we don't remember her character.
Are you switching hats between each question?
Not between each, just I'm trying to cycle through.
Sure.
Yeah. I need to remember to bring up my other hats from downstairs.
Traguna Macorum.
Okay, okay.
Okay. And regular round question number 4 from listener Lee S. What was the River Belle Terrace's name when Disneyland opened?
Oh, wasn't it Aunt Jemima's Pancake House?
Yes. Well, I'm trying to think because
if
there
it was...
If it was something before that? No, that probably is it, actually, because I was like, there was something else, but I always think that the Riverboat Terrace is closer to the Gordon Horseshoe than it is. Yeah, so Aunt Jemima's Pancake House.
Is that your final answer?
Final answer.
Okay.
Something before that, though.
I don't know.
But that's what we'll go with.
Okay. And for your bonus question from listener Om D. Name the parks that have Buzz Lightyear's Astro Blasters.
Disneyland. And the Magic Kingdom. Is he overseas?
He's at Tokyo Disneyland. And I think...
Listen closely.
Oh.
Name the parks that have Buzz Lightyear's Astro Blasters.
Disneyland. The Magic Kingdom. I'm confused.
Going off the question as I have it in front of me. And the answer that I'm looking at. Okay, so I'm sorry, I got lost. What did you say?
Magic Kingdom.
Okay.
Disneyland.
Okay.
Disneyland, or Tokyo Disneyland, and Hong Kong Disneyland. So not Paris.
Not Shanghai.
Okay. Okay.
Tokyo's got it, huh?
I think Tokyo has it, because they're big fans of Toy Story stuff.
Okay.
Well, listeners, how do you think they did? How did you do listening at home? Stay tuned until after the discussion topic to find out.
For our discussion topic this week, we decided that we wanted to chat with you about kind of our planning and what we're looking forward to for our trip this coming week to Touch of Disney.
We haven't even started, but we're
moving back. When we first started planning this trip, Touch of Disney, I don't even believe it had a name yet. I don't even think there was an official name for the event, but
there was
a rumored food and drink event coming to DCA possibly at the end of March. So we started planning, and then it got to the point that we were like, do we still want to go if they don't do the event, or if they are doing the event but we aren't able to score tickets? And we decided, you know what? Yes, it'll be great to be out in Disneyland. We can soak up some downtown Disney.
We thought Bowers Museum would be open.
Not at that point, because...
We were hoping that it would be open.
We were hoping that maybe the stars would align. And it was funny because when we first booked out how many days we were going to be there, we kind of were like, ooh, that's too much. There's really not that much going on out there. We're gonna need stuff to like fill our time. So, sure. But somehow like the Disney powers that be apparently just
worked out.
It just worked out. So not only did we get, of course, tickets to Touch of Disney, things like the extravagant, all sorts of things, all sorts of doors and windows and everything.
It must have been meant to be.
Roofs blew off too. Everything opened up for us. As far as things that we were hoping, oh, maybe this will be a thing. And so anyways, so that's kind of where we are now. So what is it? Tell us, Tag. What is the first thing after we get off the plane and we check into our hotel? What is the first thing?
Well, you and I
big thing that we are doing.
You and I are on total opposites on this, because the first thing I think I want to do after we check in is I want to go get some Blaze pizza. But I think you're going to think it's too late, even though it's only 8 p.m. Well, it'll probably be 9 p.m. their time.
So that's 11 p.m. our time.
Right. But Blaze pizza. That's all I'm saying. I love me some Blaze pizza. But if you want to go with what you're probably talking about, because what is that? That we're coming out on Friday. So Saturday morning. We, of course, are going to do the very first thing, which I know is coming, is Teresa is going to get her coffee in the morning.
Yes.
Because Teresa always gets the coffee in the morning.
Yes.
Then we're going to head over to Bowers Museum because Teresa scored us tickets, which is funny because they said the tickets were going to go on sale at like noon Pacific, and they went on sale somehow at 10 Pacific or something, and Teresa just got in. I was like, I had a reminder in the calendar. I was going to do it, and I suddenly get a email saying thanks for your purchase of tickets to Bowers, and I'm like, what? They're not even on sale yet.
Yeah, I don't know how that worked out, but it was one of those, I'm like, you know what, oh, here's the link. I was trying to be proactive and see what time is the exhibit open?
And then they were like,
and then they're
tickets.
Like, oh, do you want to buy a ticket? And I'm like, oh, yes, I do. So so we're pumped. This Bowers exhibit has, as you all know, started last. No, did it start in 2019? It may have started late 2019, if not early 2020. But it did open pre-pandemic for a short period. And then, of course, they did have to close, and they were closed for quite a while. Originally, this exhibit was not going to be around. So this exhibit was scheduled, opened March 7th of 2020. This was something we were hoping to maybe squeak in when we were going to be out there in April.
Of
2020. April of 2020, when we were going to go out for Villains Night, of course. We also had scored tickets to a Walt Disney Studios tour. It was going to be like the perfect trip. So anyways, originally it was just going to be like March until maybe August or something. It wasn't super, super long. A good chunk of time, but not forever. Anyways, thankfully, they have been able to extend it out. Not once, not twice. This might be time number three. I've kind of lost count. So we're very, very excited to be able to go and experience this. I do know other weekly tiers have gone and have really enjoyed it. I just can't wait. I cannot wait.
I'm really excited. There's a lot of cool things that are going to be in this. Mm-hmm. The fact that they are limited to timed entry and they're going to be at a lower capacity will mean that there won't be a bunch of people like in front of you when you're trying at things. Because that's been, even when I went to the Walt Disney Family Museum, it was kind of like that. Sometimes you'd have to, you know, somebody would be enjoying the exhibit in front of you. And there are people who want to read like everything. And I just want to see what the thing says. One thing that's interesting, and I don't know if you guys have ever done this at a museum, but this is a pro tip, I think, is I do want to read a lot of the stuff, but I know that it takes time. And with the fact that they're only letting a certain amount of people, I also don't want to hold up things. So what I will generally do is I will take out my phone and I will take a picture of the plaques with all the stuff that it says, and then I'll take a picture of the thing. I will look at it in person to enjoy it and take that in. And then later I'll go back and read the little info about it when I have more time at my leisure. It also helps because then you can go back if you want to like look something up again. Mm-hmm. So that's something that I do. In fact, we went into a museum. We went on a cruise a couple years ago. We went into a museum, but we had to get back to the boat. And literally, I looked like a crazy person. I walked into a room. I took three or four pictures of the different plaques. I looked around. I took like a panoramic. Went to the next room. I got through a museum in like 20 minutes. But I went back and looked at it. But yes, I'm very excited to see all this stuff in person with all the Disney history and archive stuff. I'm also very excited to see more archives exhibits as they come out. We've reported on that before as well.
Yes. Vern does the same thing with the whole taking pictures of the plaques.
It's smart.
He loves reading all of the stuff about things whenever we go. In fact, not off topic. We went on a family walk on Sunday, and we went out to the Seven Bridges Road trail thing. And they had like this little history, you know, like this little history write up. And it's me, Vern, the two dogs. We're like outside and they're so excited. And Luna's like smelling everything and like pulling and like they're ready to go. And Vern's like, oh, no. We need to read about the history of this road. I'm like, these poor dogs do not understand that we need to
take a picture and move on.
He didn't take a picture, but we came back. And when we were done and the dogs were tired out, then he was able to read it. Yep. He did get some cool, interesting facts off of it before we started. So he was informing me as we were going.
You know, there's kind of off topic. We went to the train bridge or the train tunnel that's out by Sparta. And I had been out there a bunch of times and not read anything. And when we went out there with Simone before he left, I actually read the things and learned a lot of cool stuff. So I'm hoping to learn some cool things at the archives exhibit.
I don't know how we won't. I mean, we're going to be overwhelmed.
Sure.
Hopefully whatever our chunk of time is feels like we can absorb as much as we want.
What are we doing after this?
So after this is like the real Blaze pizza time that we've decided.
For like lunch?
Yeah, we're going to have Blaze for lunch. I told Tag I wasn't sure how tired I would be after we get in because like Tag said, we're getting in later.
I might leave you in the hotel and go get pizza, I'm telling you.
So yes, so Bowers is like the highlight of Saturday. And then Saturday afternoon and evening.
I mean, it's highlight, but like later we get to go have some food with the community managers. That's going to be exciting.
Well, yes, of course. But I'm like, it's Bowers. Anyways, that's like the big thing for Saturday. And then, yes, the afternoon we are going to just bum around downtown Disney. We do have dinner reservations at Tortilla Joe's. I have never been there, so I'm quite excited to try the guacamole I've heard so much about.
Teresa laughed at me because she's like, we're going to have a drink and some chips and guac and whatever. And I was like, I don't like either of those things. She said margaritas. Margaritas and chips and guac. And I'm like, I don't like guacamole and I don't really like margaritas. So I'm going to have a Dr. Pepper because I know they have Dr. Pepper and chips and salsa. They have good salsa. And some plate of good food.
And some plate of something.
And I won't recreate Katzberg first time eating a taco. He used his fork and knife. And I'm like, no.
I think that's adorable. That he didn't know. That's a good way to, that's honestly, it's a pretty smart way to eat a taco if you're trying to be not messy.
You want to laugh about eating things? So we made those every plate, like hamburger things. Yes. And I ate it with a fork and knife because it's so gooey.
See?
Okay, so that's, so what are we doing after we eat dinner? This is good.
Downtown Disney.
This is good because honestly, I don't know what the schedule is for
Downtown Disney. We're just going to hang and soak up Downtown Disney because why not? That's Saturday. And then of course,
Sunday
is going to be our meetup and Touch of Disney, which I don't even know where to begin with what I'm excited about for Touch of Disney. I think we might want to try and do the extravaganza on Saturday afternoon as
well. Oh, sure. I know you're very excited.
And we need
to
check out the Raya mural.
I mean, we're going to have time.
I know. Like, we're going to have lots of time.
Just hopefully it won't be super, super busy and we can get into some stores.
Yes.
But so I think with Touch of Disney there, I think that it's not as busy in the Downtown Disney part, maybe.
We'll find out. We will definitely find out.
Well, so Sunday we have the meetup, right? You were saying in the morning. That'll be really exciting. And then we'll head over to go in. And then I don't even know how you're picking food. Did you go through and pick out some things?
I have. I haven't. I'm not quite as organized as others, and I don't have like a list per se. What are the top? We'll limit it so these folks don't have to listen to us talk about the 30 different food items that we're very excited about.
I really want to try, since now that we have a reservation at Carthay, I want to try their tacos. Because I've heard amazing things about that. And I obviously want to have this Fluffernutter churro, which we've talked about at great length.
Oh, yes.
I also want to
I forgot
have,
about the Fluffernutter churro already.
Right? I also want to have,
beef skewer?
Beef skewer. Those are like the only things that I think are on my list that I absolutely have to have. I was a little disappointed because they said online that the s'mores, like milkshake or something that they had, like, looked really good, but like did not taste good.
Really? Now see, the some of the reviews that I watched Ordinary Adventures.
Okay.
I watched their video on it and she really liked it. They tried it. They were kind of surprised because it's a s'more. So what do you normally think of when you eat a s'mores tasting thing? That it's a lot of chocolate, a lot of graham crackers.
Yeah.
She said the flavor that came through the most actually was the marshmallow.
See,
so that makes that makes me more interested in this because I think the chocolate is perhaps just like the chocolate and the graham cracker are just kind of like on the side of the glass for decoration.
Sure.
So maybe if you
stir it
mix
up.
It, you get more of the blending of flavors.
So look at this. This is Liberty, our community manager. She has this wonderful thing that she
it's great.
Did that has like what she, you know. Priority and all that stuff, which is great. Where it's at. See, this is important because you don't want to be spending a bunch of time backtracking and going from one thing to another and to another and coming back.
Exactly.
But personally, I think what'll happen for me is, and you have to kind of keep me honest on this one, when we first get there and we do our like lap to kind of get the lay of the land, I'll call it, because that's what I like to do.
You're going to make me wait to eat?
Well, you can eat something, grab something, and grab a churro, and we'll do our lap.
We'll do the Fluffernutter churro first.
But as we walk around, I think you'll have to remind me to just jot down if I see something that looks good. Because two things will happen. I'll see the pictures, which will always look better. Or I'll see people walk by with something, and I'll be like, what was that? I want that. I do that at restaurants, too, because I'll order food, and then I'll see somebody walk by with something, and I'll be like, what is that?
I want that one of those.
Didn't that happen at Blue Bayou when we were there? Didn't somebody walk by with the glowing thing?
Yes, it was the glow cube. You didn't even ask what the drink was. You just knew it had a glow cube, so you needed it. Oh, no, that also happened at Be Our Guest.
Oh, good, yes, yes.
Because they had a glow. I think it's just this, glowing.
And then
glowing
at,
items.
At Lamplight Lounge, I definitely want to try the tuna poke.
Oh.
Because that looks real good.
You know, a lot of people have been interested in that. That's not something that I've looked at and thought, ooh, must have.
Well, that's what this picture is.
Yeah, yeah.
But you're not really... Well,
I'm not a fish person, really, so...
You eat sushi, though.
Yes, different, but what is in my sushi? Not
That's
raw
true.
Fish.
That's true.
So, yeah. Anyways, so some of the things that I'm looking forward to, I'm going to go, of course, like the Bengal barbecue skewers. Yum. I'm very excited about those. Yes, the fluffer nut churro. So I'm really excited, you guessed it, for Dole Whip. However, I have a kerfuffle. I'm very glad that we're going to be there for 2 days because, of course, we have our classic Dole Whip. There's also It's Lemon soft serve, which, of course, you normally can get at the adorable snowman stand.
Sure.
But they are actually swirling the lemon with the pineapple.
Oh.
Not something I would have tended towards on my own. But again, I've heard lots of really good reviews about this, that the blend of flavors, even though it sounds maybe not great, is actually quite good. So I think I'm going to have a classic Dole Whip and then also try the blended one on the second day.
I really have liked the Dole Whips recently because there's just something that's really refreshing about them.
Yes. Another thing I'm excited to try is, I don't know if it's a priority or not, but I'm intrigued, is Poultry Palace. Mm. I have not tried Poultry Palace before, so I'm very excited to check them out.
I feel like I need to try a cake pop, too.
A cake pop?
I love cake pops.
There you go. And then the other thing that I'm quite excited about over at the Cocina Cucamonga, that, of course, is not the beef skewers. I want basically everything on this menu, minus The jalapeno bacon peanut brittle, just no thank you, that's not for me. But they have a Papa's street tacos and an Asian style beef barbacoa street taco, and
I love street tacos.
You can order, so when you order the tacos, you get, they come in twos, so you can either get two of the potato tacos, two of the beef tacos, or you can get one of each, which is perfect because I wanted to try both anyways. So those are the things that I'm really looking forward to, along with like 30 other items.
Just glancing through. I know it's not Disney. Well, we'll get to there, I guess.
Oh, you forgot about your Monte Cristo.
I want to try the Monte Cristo, but it's not one of those. Like, it'll be there at Disneyland when Disneyland opens, so I guess I'm not too worried about that. Churro-wise, they have... What is this one again? This is the horchata churro. Is that on your list?
That is on my list. I am curious about that, too. I think we're going to do one churro a day, so we'll maybe do like the fluffernutter churro the first day, and then we can try the horchata churro the next day. Try and space out the sweets a little bit. There are some drinks that I'm quite interested in as well. There is over at Delish Farmstead Punch. It is a non-alcoholic punch. There's also a...
I, of course, want these light up grape.
Of course you do. It lights up. And there's also a watermelon agua fresca.
Oh, I would want to try that.
That I'm pretty excited about to try as well.
This, what is this?
That's gumbo.
That looks good.
And on that also, see, I gotta stop looking at these pictures. The grilled beef tenderloin slider with chimichurri and pickled onions.
That also looks
very good. So good.
The good thing about their sliders, though, is they're usually fairly small.
Yeah, so the photos and images that I've seen of the sliders and videos, too, is, yes, like, the bun is small, but the hunk of meat is, like, an inch tall. It's a big... It's a big sandwich. So I think that's one that we could share.
Yeah.
And be totally fine with. Oh, we got to stop scrolling.
The carbonara mac and cheese.
I want to try the carbonara mac and cheese. I'm also interested in the sweet and spicy chicken wings and the strawberry rose lemonades, another drink that I want to try. Oh, there's just so many choices. I'm very, very glad that we were able to somehow miraculously get 2 days at Touch of Disney, because there's just no way my stomach would be able to handle all of the foods that I want to try. And I get so excited about all of them. I don't know how to pick if I had to. So I'm very excited.
So
we don't have to pick.
Kate, you had Walt's chili. Does Walt's chili have a lot of beans in it? Because I'm more of a fan of chili when it doesn't have beans in it. And you know what's funny? My sister-in-law one time, she made some chili, and it tasted just like Disneyland's chili. I'm like, this tastes just like Disneyland's chili. This is really good. I got to get your recipe. She's like, well, it's a can of Hormel.
Yeah. So that's all of our excitement when it comes to Touch of Disney. We do have reservations at Carthay Circle. We hope to also be able to enjoy Lamplight Lounge. I feel like that view is just amazing.
Kate said that it was more meaty, so I'm going to maybe try Walt's chili at some point.
Yeah.
Now, So we got through all of that. What are we doing on Tuesday?
So then Tuesday, because we haven't eaten enough food Sunday and Monday, Tuesday, we're going to go check out Knott's Berry Farm, which this will be the first time I've ever been to Knott's Berry Farm. So I'm very excited to see what it's like.
So long.
Yes. And it's been a very long time for Tag. Plus, they also have an Easter egg hunt, which I'm excited about. So I've actually been doing a lot of research on Knott's since that's not something that I am familiar with. So I've been watching a lot of videos, reading a lot of different like write-ups on different foods, because their menu, I'll be honest, when we first pulled up and looked at the menu, very overwhelming, because it looks like there's a million different options.
But
when you look through it, it's not a million options. It's the same options over and over.
Which is good, because then you're not like, I want Walt's chili, for an example, but I have to get it at this one place.
Exactly.
It's like, I want Walt's chili and I can get it at five places.
Nope, exactly. So that'll be nice. And I want to kind of make sure that we check out all of the park. And I think we'll be able to do that because of the egg hunt. That'll kind of force us. I do think their egg hunt's going to be pretty difficult since we're not familiar with their park.
I feel like this is going to be challenging too, because in the future when we go, we're probably going to want to go to Knott's Berry Farm.
No, I'm going to have to check it out. I'm not a big roller coaster person.
They have a variety.
Do they?
Yeah.
Because like I'm like California Screamin' is like, that's like that's like the top. I don't want to do like the Universal Studios roller coasters too much.
Yeah, you don't have to go on all those things. They have a Thunder Mountain kind of train thing, like a Runaway Mine train. They've got a regular train. They've got a lot of stuff that's medium.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
So I want to go experience
some of the things. I started a list for Knott's Berry Farm.
You only have four things on the list.
I know.
From what
I'm doing very well because, yes. So there's, they have elote corn. I totally butchered that, but they have elote.
Okay.
Corn.
What is that?
Which it's like an ear of corn that's then rolled in like a butter mayonnaise, and then it's got like stuff sprinkled on top.
That sounds amazing.
It looks super good. And apparently they're kind of known for their corn on the cob. So I feel like I extra have to try that. They also have boysenberry tamales. Now, I love tamales. Is one of my favorite foods when I was growing up and would have birthdays.
Do you like boysenberries?
I do like boysenberry.
Oh, well, there you go.
And I would have birthdays. A lot of times we would go out to visit my family in Arizona. And that was always my meal of choice for my birthday was tamales. Every time we go out to a restaurant and they have tamales, I have to get them. I love tamales. So very, very excited.
I'm surprised I haven't seen you eat more tamales. I feel like I've not seen you eat a lot of tamales.
We don't go whenever I go to Senior Via, tamales.
Oh, okay.
Anyways, very excited for the tamales. I'm also curious to try. They have a boysenberry pineapple agua fresca.
That sounds good.
And then Kate sent a elote. Thank you, Kate. So I'm very excited for the elote corn.
Okay. And Kate said what now? No.
Oh, so Kate was, she had gone to the Knott's Berry Farm event. And so she was telling us about some of the awesome foods that she tried. There's a key lime tart that wasn't even on my radar that now has made my list that I'm very excited about.
Maybe I'll take a small, I'm not a lime or a lime-ish person or a lemon person. So I'm interested to try that. The only thing that I remember seeing on the list, and I haven't looked at it completely, again, been too busy with other things, is the boysenberry macaron.
Yes. And I think I saw that you get two of them, not just one.
Well, I mean, it'll be like everywhere else you'll have some.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm very excited about that. Mm-hmm. I do like boysenberries as well, so I'm interested to see the different things. We did get somebody recommend, Connie, I think it was, recommended that we eat like breakfast at the restaurant.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And she was, but I said, we need all of the room because she was like, they had like unlimited biscuits or something. And I'm like, mm-hmm. that sounds like it's going to fill your stomach. So that's a no. But so I think that'll be really good. I'm excited to be there. The next day, which is Wednesday, mm-hmm. we are going to try to head up to City Walk outside Universal because I have a hankering for a butterbeer.
Me too.
And I have a feeling that I'm going to buy like four butterbeers because
it's
going to
be the churro toffee all over again. I can just see it now.
That's good though. Because then
I'll be like halfway through the second one and be like, oh no.
Oh no. I'll be like halfway through like my fourth one and be like, I think I'm done.
The other thing that I'm pretty excited about, so Universal, as you may or may not know, is a little bit of a drive from the Disneyland area. It's about like, what, 45-ish minutes according to the map. So throw in traffic, who knows? Anyways, it's on the other side of the Hollywood Hills. So I've actually never seen the Hollywood sign.
Really?
No, I haven't. So I'm pretty excited about that.
If
and
it's nice out, we should go up. There's some walking trails by the Griffith Observatory.
Yes.
With beautiful views of Los Angeles.
And is Griffith Park not over there as well? We can go
check out
the park. Check out the carousel if it's still there. And then the studios are kind of sort of over nearish that area as well. So I think it'd be fun to, obviously we can't go visit, but it'd be fun just to drive past.
Yeah, I think just doing a little bit of sightseeing. I will say that the last time producer James and I went to Hollywood a few years ago, and I can't imagine that it's gotten any better, is it was kind of, you were talking about like worried about people, the safety of yourself around there.
Mm-hmm.
Hollywood, that whole area by the Chinese Theater and El Capitan is not the best. The big takeaway from all of this is you have an idea of knowing where we will be each day. So if you do see us out and about, please come say hi. We have goodies that we give to people when we meet them in person. So please, please, please come say hi.
So that was really funny because you're like, when the big takeaway and I was thinking about all of the yummy, delicious food. But yes, you also will know kind of where we're going to be hanging out. So please come
say
hi.
There's also been another announcement, and they are not sponsors, but I do want to point this out, that the Howard Johnson Anaheim will be opening at the end of April.
That's great news.
They announced that, I think, April 30th. They announced that Sunday. They had a big like live stream that they announced
that's
it.
Awesome.
So I'm glad we really had a great time there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would definitely recommend that to anybody. I'm excited to see what our hotel this time will be like. It looks really good.
Yes.
It is slightly closer.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm excited for that. Our friends over at All Enchanting Ears, they've recommended, I should say,
Hyatt House.
The Hyatt House. So, and they've stayed there a few times and they liked it.
Mm-hmm.
You eventually are hoping, maybe if we go this summer, things will be open and maybe we can go stay at one of the smaller hotels.
I really want to check out the Candy Cane Inn. That's been on my like must try.
Well, hopefully they reopen.
They will. Anyways, we're super excited, if you weren't able to tell, to be back in the parks, to be back just in that Disney bubble. And just the fact that we get to do so many extras, go check out Knott's Berry Farm, go sip on butter beer over at City Walk. So, and then Bowers. Bowers was like the huge surprise.
Sure.
And it's like, to me, that's like the cherry on top. I'm so excited to go walk through and see and be like surrounded literally by history.
Now, we're crossing off some things that we've wanted to do, which is great. Future trips, we need to get to the barn.
Yes.
When it's finally open and actually experience that.
Yes.
I'd love to get to, again, it's a lot further away, but I'd love to get to the Walt Disney Family Museum.
Yes, me too.
Studios. Your thing that you've been asking about forever is getting down to Marslin.
I do. I really want to go to I really want to check out Marslin, Missouri.
Yep. So.
I also very much, one of these days, we will definitely be doing a studio tour. The other thing that
I can't wait till they open
want to do, and I don't know if they're going to do it, Bob Gurr does these great bus tours.
Yes.
I want to take a Bob Gurr bus tour so bad.
I want to do anything with Bob Gurr. Bob Gurr is just such an awesome, I don't know, there's something just about his enthusiasm for all this stuff.
He seems so Gertinis. Yes, he seems so kind and genuine and just like full of energy and zest. I love it.
So we'll have the link in the show notes to the food for Touch of Disney and the food for Knott's and all of that stuff.
We'll
also
have a link for Bowers if you guys are interested in checking out the archives exhibit too.
And we hope to see a lot of you guys at the meetup on that Sunday. But again, if you see us around any of the other places we've talked about, please come say hi, because we love meeting you guys. And it's so cool, especially when we've like talked to people either through email or through Instagram or Facebook or through our Discord chat, to actually like put a physical person to that online persona that we've met.
Yes.
That's always fun. Now it's time to return to Trivia Land with producer Vern to get the answers to this week's trivia.
All right, welcome back. You know, you did better than you've done in the past.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean,
finally.
This was a solid night for you. I was impressed. So, kind of split. I mean, sometimes one of you was dead on and the other was nowhere near, but it was a good night for you.
It's a team effort. Thank you. Team effort.
No, it was a good night for you. Some questions you were like half right and then halfway off. But no, this was a solid night. So let's get right into it. Your first question that was submitted by listener Melissa S. In California Adventure, the store Elias and Company has a unique replica suit in the store. Whose suit is it and where was it from? You guessed Roy wore it to the opening day of Disneyland.
World.
But Teresa, no. World. Oh, you said world. Well, either way, Teresa had it correct when she said that Walt wore it to the premiere of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
We're going to have to look in Elias because I didn't even know, but that's cool.
I know. I'm going to have to pay attention to it. So the reason I went there was because of Carthay.
I mean, that's smart. It does thematically work.
That's why I went there.
Yeah. Well done.
Thanks, Melissa S. for that one.
Yes, good question.
Question number two, submitted by listener Donna S. Who christened the Mark Twain at Disneyland and what was used for said christening? You are exactly correct with the bottle of water from all of the rivers across the U.S., the represented rivers. But the person who did said christening was actress Irene Dunne, widely considered one of the best actresses to have never won an Academy Award.
Her and Meryl Streep is the other one everybody thinks that she,
Yep.
Well, thanks, Donna S., for that one, even though we only got it half right.
You know, I was more confident about it being Lillian than I was the river water, so I'm pretty impressed that we got the part that we got right was
because
the river
at the
water.
Opening of It's a Small World, they had children from all around the world pour different things in, so I was like, was it that? Because it seems like they wouldn't do it again.
I know, that's kind of, I'm like, am I crossing my wires here? But yeah, that's awesome.
Apparently
I love
not.
It.
Well done. Question number three, submitted by listener Todd B. In the Haunted Mansion, in Madame Leota's spellbook, the incantation of Kree, Kra, Virgo, Gaba, Kalto, Kree is listed. Which Disney movie is this incantation featured in? This one, you got nothing. The incantation is said in Blackbeard's Ghost to conjure the ghost of Captain Blackbeard, which came out about a year and a half before the mansion opened.
I've never seen that movie.
Nope, I'm not sad that we got that one wrong because I would not... Never would I have known that.
It did sound like a Bedknobs and Broomsticks thing, though.
It did. That was a good
effort. You weren't, when you said Bedknobs and Broomsticks, I was like, good guess. Because at least had good sound behind it. Mm-hmm. So not terrible, yeah.
Thank you for that one, Todd.
Yeah. Question number four, submitted by listener Lee S. What was Riverbell Terrace's name when Disneyland opened? You nailed it right away. First guess, Aunt Jemima Pancake House.
Good job.
Well done on that one. And then your bonus round question submitted by listener Om D. Buzz Lightyear's Astro Blasters, specifically by that name, exists in Disneyland.
Do we know what they're called at the other parks?
Yes. In the other parks, they can be found as Buzz Lightyear's Space Ranger Spin.
Oh.
Is that what we did?
Buzz Lightyear Planet Rescue. Buzz Lightyear Laser Blast.
Disney, just naming things different things.
Same thing, different name.
So,
Good job, Om, for stumping us on that
one. I do like the...
Om got you on the technicality of the name.
There. Astro Blaster versus, what was it, Laser something?
Yeah,
Laser Gun, maybe?
Not Laser Gun.
Laser Blast.
Laser Blast. It was very close. Very close.
Yep.
You know what? I need to watch the Toy Story movies again.
They're cute. You know, it's really interesting watching the first Toy Story movie now with how far the animation quality has come and like looking at what that looks like now because it looked amazing when it came out.
Maybe I will have to watch on the way home from Touch of Disney. Maybe that's what I'll watch on the plane.
There you go.
Well, listeners, how do you think they did? How did you do listening at home? Do you think that you've got the question that can really stump them next week?
Or be really nice to us?
Or if you really wanted to be really nice to them, you could try that too. If you've got some great questions that you'd like to send in for producer James or I to ask them, feel free to do so at trivia@dlweekly.net.
We will be back next week with more Disneyland news and information.
From inside the park.
Yes.
Until then, have courage, be kind, and spread some Disney magic.
And we hope to see you all, as many of you as we can, at our DL Weekly meetup or even at Touch of Disney.
Yeah, if you see us, come say hi.
Ladies and gentlemen, Disneyland has now ended its normal operating day. We hope you've enjoyed your visit to the Magic Kingdom and that you'll be back with us again soon.